All right, everyone, welcome to the show. Good to have you here. Tennessee WildCast, the weekly podcast of the Tennessee Wildlife Resources Agency. Hope you're having a good almost spring. We're getting there, aren't we, Jason?
Yeah, it's, you know, starting to see some weather today. So
and this is when the peepers start a little bit. Talking a little bit outside. I saw my first blooming buttercup the other day.
Mm-hmm.
That seems spring to me. Baseball spring training's about to start.
Birds chirping and
fishing. People are killing the fish.
Skunks are running around.
It's mating time. I saw that on our Facebook the other day. Jason Harmon, Doug Markham. We'll get to our guest here in a minute. It's we're going to have a cool show today.
Mm-hmm.
We're going to talk about something we hadn't talked about much lately.
A real good show, I think.
So it's going to be good. What's going on right now? We're kind of wrapping up the couple of weeks left, 3 weeks or so left of the small game seasons.
Yep. Snow geese are...
We've got a light goose season.
Going to be available here pretty soon.
What's a light goose?
Yeah.
Anyway, if you want to know what a light goose is, go into our website and you can see what a light goose is.
And get that free permit.
Snow Goose is free permit to go out there, but you can read about it on our site. We put it on our Facebook the other day. But if you want to still get out and waterfowl hunting, you know where there's a bunch of snow geese or whatever else is in that light goose family,
mm-hmm.
you can go hunt for them still. And that's a season they're having because they're trying to reduce the population some of these birds across country.
Yep.
And let's see what else is going on. NWTF, right?
NWTF is right around the corner. And
we
you
are
can
the
buy,
home city of NWTF.
We are. It's Opryland every year. And you can buy your new license.
Yeah, it's the National Wild Turkey Federation. And, yeah, in about 2 weeks, about the 19th of the month, the licenses for next year go on sale if you're one of those who buy them annually.
Right.
If you got a lifetime, you don't have to worry about it, do you?
Nope.
And anyway, those are going to be available. The good news, that's the bad news that you have to buy them. The good news is they're not going up in price.
Right? And the hard cards, don't forget about those. Those are a neat feature for the new licenses.
Worked with Barry Cross the other day, and we're going to do a Facebook feature on the hard cards. These things were they're an option if you want to buy them. They're a whopping $5 extra, but they're like a credit card. You can't use them like a credit card. They're credit card size. You stick them in your wallet.
Right.
They're durable. You have your license, all your information on the back of them.
Mm-hmm.
You can still get your paper copies if you want to, but the hard copy is going to be like a collector's thing.
Yep.
Our guest today is a big collector of the man that we're working with on there because he's famous.
His artwork.
Gallatin, Tennessee, Ralph McDonald.
Mm-hmm.
And if you see the hard copy, one's of a deer. We're going to have one coming up pretty soon. It's got a fish on it, a largemouth jumping out of the water. And there are going to be collector's licenses. And we'll talk more about that in a few weeks, okay?
Yep.
But anyway, it is almost that time. Let's introduce our guest.
Yeah.
Colonel. This is the Colonel, Darren Rider.
How are y'all this morning?
Good. Good to have you here, Darren. First time you've been on with us.
It is, and I know you'll probably see my hat, so I don't know if that was a bribe or an incentive
bribe.
To get me here. So I'm wearing my hat today.
Yeah.
Anything we have to.
As my token.
If you come back, we'll give you a shirt.
There you go.
All right. Well, Darren is the colonel over here at Tennessee Wildlife Resources Agency, which means he has a lot of folks he works with in the wildlife officers across the state. You work out of the Nashville office, and you work with officers in the regions and out in the counties. Is that right?
That's correct. It's the law enforcement. Actually, it's the boating and law enforcement division. So we incorporated the boating aspect of the agency's business a few years back. We merged both divisions. There was a separate boating division, and there was a separate law enforcement division. Then Director Carter merged the two divisions about 6 years ago, and so now it's together. And it parallels one another, and it makes all the sense because our officers are multi-purpose,
for sure,
whether
for
they
sure.
do wildlife work or whether they do boating work enforcement-wise. So it made all the sense in the world to put two divisions together.
There's so many questions and things I want to talk. We're going to talk about some of what y'all do and some of the things that y'all don't know that our officers do here in Tennessee. And I just got a lot of things on my mind. But let's stay there with the officers for a minute. How many are there across in Tennessee?
Well, we have a couple categories. We have 235 mandatory commissions by state law officers and supervisors, which are your county officers and your field supervisors for the most part. Then there's another group of non-mandatory commission positions and that the law doesn't require, but what's happened is these employees had started out a career in law enforcement, moved to another position, but they've been able to retain their gun and commission, and they're a huge asset in situations where we need extra force to work these opening
like
weekends.
Like a boating weekend
or
July 4th, that
kind
of thing.
And then we have another program that's been just a great asset is we have part-time boating officers is what the category. We have about 40 of those, and these officers are actually full-time with another department, whether it's a city police department, whether it's a county sheriff's department, or whether it's another state agency. And you're talking about a huge asset on our peak holiday weekends, during our boating season. They can fill in those gaps and give us that coverage we need, because as folks well know, that the boating season is busy. A lot of participation, so it's very helpful to have these extra guys in boats for patrol work.
Do the folks out on the water understand that a lot? We get, of course, the folks we work with a lot in the field, in the woods, and even when we check when they're fishing, they know who we are. They have an idea. What about the folks on boating that go boating? They're not fishing at all. You won't find a fishing rod. They're just out there having a good time. Do they know who we are?
They should. I think it's just well established when we show up in one of our patrol boats, the white, the green, and the orange, and that signifies with our blue lights that we're there for their safety. And that involves basically checking for boat registrations and certainly life jackets, running lights when they're required, skiing restrictions, and more importantly, here in the last 10 years is the focus on boating under the influence. And that's been a big component of our enforcement effort, is to watch out for those impaired operators.
And just a second on that, is it same as DUI, the BUI, as far as the, I don't want to get too deep into that because there's too much
pretty
to
much
cover, but is it pretty
it
much
it parallels
same?
The road law for DUI.
Yeah.
It's same 0.08, and so all the restrictions there, operating privileges can be revoked, some court time, some jail time, and all that
It seems DUI. Like in recent years, folks know y'all making cases, but it doesn't seem like it's overwhelming anymore. Like maybe they understand you guys are out there.
Well, I think our guys have been super trained on the detection of the BUI, and then I think the general culture now in the last few years, what I've been able to detect is the messages got out that we're out there, we're looking for this. So what's been valuable is they have taken – the boating public has taken on herself to provide a designated operator, if you will. So we're seeing a lot of that now. Good. Is there aware it's against the law to operate while impaired? So now they're having their designated drivers, in which we are good with.
Okay. All right. And while we're just on the subject of boating, don't forget boating course that's coming around the corner. You can take a course. You got to take a test if you're born 89 or after.
Correct.
And you don't have to take the course, but I recommend it, especially if you can get somebody like an Alan Harold teaching that course and a lot of other guys out there that do it.
A lot of avenues to get that certification.
There is. And you said something to begin. They're multi-talented. They have to do a lot of different things is what that means. It's not just enforcement all the time, but we get a lot of questions there. What do you have to have in Tennessee to be a wildlife officer? Can you just go to high school and get the degree, or what does it take?
Well, there's a minimum education requirement, and that's a Bachelor of Science degree. And that can be in wildlife management or fisheries management.
Okay.
It can be in wildlife or fisheries biology, or it can be in natural resources.
Okay.
And it's a Bachelor of Science degree.
All right. And we have lots of colleges in Tennessee teach them. Tennessee Tech and UT and Martin.
Lincoln Memorial.
And there's
a couple other universities that have supplied their curriculum to be accepted, like Memphis University, and then also Union University in Jackson, Tennessee. They're looking to try to get their degree requirement acceptable by us.
Great. All right. So you got to go that route. You got a human resources office and a website that can teach you all that stuff too. But I guess that's one of my most asked questions. Standing behind a booth, I'm not a wildlife officer, but I work with you guys, and through the years, it's been, how do I become a wildlife officer? It's a very popular position.
Greatest job in the world.
I
had your job.
Yeah, heard that a lot. I'm sure you have. All right, Darren, let's talk about you a little bit. You are the colonel. You've risen through the ranks and become colonel of the agency in the law enforcement side and boating side. Where did you start?
It's a humble beginning. When I graduated from college, a couple weeks later, they placed me at Lake Graham in Jackson, Tennessee, to where I was hired as a seasonal helper. And basically, I cut grass, emptied trash, cleaned bathrooms, and sold fish permits. That's how I started.
You cleaned bathrooms, did you?
I had to.
I love it. That's awesome. Did you work with Bobby Wilson back then days? Was he there?
Bobby had gone to the regional office as a regional fish guy. So Jeff Bailey was the lake manager, and that's actually who I reported to.
Okay. Well, Bobby's our assistant director. I just wondered because I knew he had some time there.
Yes.
So I'd like to have a photograph of that. Anyway, so what happened from there?
Then after that, I was able to get hired as a wildlife officer for Macon County.
Macon?
That's my first county. I was the Macon County Flash, is what they called me back then. So I spent a year there, And then at the time, I was able to transfer to Davidson, which at the time, not too many people took the initiative to come to Davidson County.
That's because Nashville, of the big city. That's Nashville, if you don't know, right.
Yeah. Because of the big city. But I had family ties here, and at the time, my girlfriend, which is my current wife, my only
current wife.
She was here, and I wanted to get back towards her. And so, and Davidson County offered Percy Priest Lake, which I enjoyed working the boating
aspect. Did you work with Mitch Bailey back then?
Absolutely.
Okay.
And he was my county partner, because it was a two-man county in Davidson at the time. So we worked a lot of Percy Priest. And then if you get out in the northern part of Davidson County, the Jolton area, the Gulletsville area, man, there's a lot of deer hunting, a lot of small game hunting, a lot of dove hunting.
So, I think Davidson County still kills 1,000 deer a year or something like that.
Yeah, so it was attractant to me. And I spent a year there, and then Cheatham County came open. And then I transferred to Cheatham, and, man, I spent a lot of years in Cheatham County. And it had a management area, had the river, had a waterfowl area. So it even offered more opportunity to do a lot of aspects of work. Then about 2000, I left Cheatham County and came to the Nashville office, and I was the sole boating investigator. So I was responsible for all boating accident investigations. And then as that necessity increased, we were able to add a second investigator to help with that program of boat accident investigation. Then about 2005, Assistant Chief, you remember Dickie Wilson?
I do remember Dickie.
He retired. Sure. So I promoted to the assistant chief of the division. At the time, Director Carter was the chief of boating. So I spent a couple years as his assistant chief. And then about 2008, Chief Carter became Director Carter, which opened up a slot for me to be the boating chief. And so I spent 2 years as the division chief in boating. Like we talked about earlier, law enforcement and boating were separate. Then Director Carter merged two divisions. So I've been the colonel of the division since about 2010, for the last 6 years.
Okay. All right. All right. Everything cool?
Yeah.
All right. All right. All right. Good.
So that's me.
That's a process. And so it's taken you
30 years?
30 years. All right.
And you're right there with me.
I am. I sure am.
You're just right there with me.
All right, Darren. There are the folks out there know that you work the hunting and fishing stuff. They know that you do that. They know, most of them, I think, know we do the boating stuff, but they don't know some of the other things that we do, and that's a lot of what we want to talk about today. And you mentioned one already, and I want to get back to it, and that's boat investigation. Yes, we're out there. You guys are out there working the water daily, but if there's an accident, maybe a serious accident, it entails a whole lot more than just looking at what happened and going back to the house.
Right, and that's through state statute. We're mandated to investigate boating accidents, and through a program, a national standard program, through training, all our guys have been trained to a national level standard to investigate boating accidents. So that's just part of our responsibility. Actually, that's mandated through law that we investigate these boating accidents. We present those investigations to the local district attorney, and then they look at it and review it and decide whether any charges will come forth or not out of each of those investigations.
But if you go to school to do it, I mean, it takes a lot to figure out who, where boat A might have hit boat B and the impact and the direction, all that kind of stuff is something that you've got to figure out as part of an investigator.
Hard to find skid marks on the water.
It is.
And it's sure. Hard to, you know, when you have debris and results of a crash on the roads, there's all kinds of stuff to look at, photograph on the water. You have to be really trained to look at all that stuff that you just mentioned, and because a lot of that stuff sinks, so we have a dive team that can go and recover some of that. We have a underwater robot that helps in those investigations, so that's a useful tool. So, yeah, our guys are very specialized in that, and they do a phenomenal job with that.
Okay, and we've had Matt on talking about that robot. That is
awesome
stuff that's helping recovery. But, and that brings to the other thing we do on the water, and that's recovery, rescue and recovery. Work with a lot of folks across the state in these local rescue units and all that, but it's something we're also trained in and working on all the time. Work you'd rather not do, but you have to.
Yeah, it's just part of the good stewards of our agency is to try to provide some of those aspects where the recovery piece is part of those.
Okay. All right. We also have something. We also have an airplane. I don't know how people know we have an airplane.
Yeah, Miss Barber's our pilot. She does a great job. She's got a plane that is multifunctional. Again, that right now a lot of her work is bat survey, bat work that she does. And then, of course, during the winter.
Bat as in?
Bats. Like, okay. Yeah. Indiana bats, gray bats, all the above. So okay. She's doing some census surveys through that airplane.
Okay.
And I've not been able to. I want to do that because it would be new to me. But during the winter is waterfowl counts. So she's responsible for those waterfowl counts.
And she's under the law enforcement division?
Yes. Okay. That she's underneath our division. Okay. And then along some of those other surveys is the elk survey, so the guys can get up there and monitor some elk. And, you know, here of late, some hog work. She'll get up there and do some reconnaissance on where some hog problems are and try to direct the ground troops to help with the eradication program of that. And then she goes every year to Texas and grabs a load of fish to bring back for us.
That's those largemouth, right? Yep. Florida largemouth bass.
So we get a load of fish. So she's very, very helpful in that retrospect.
She's awesome. I've never flown with her, but I have flown with, this is how long I've been in, the same person you flew with 30 years ago, and that's Dick Stark.
Amazing.
Who still works for us as a dispatcher. He's an awesome guy.
He is incredible.
He is an awesome guy. Anyway, so that's an aviation program that we have, and when she brings back those Florida largemouth, by the way, they're only about that big.
I know, they're tiny. Yes.
They have a long way to go.
That's about the size you've been catching, right?
I don't think I can get that anymore. All right. We also have something called an honor guard.
Yes.
What's an honor guard?
Well, that was the vision of one of our captains, Matt Majors, kind of institute that he came.
Matt's also the person that runs the robot on the bottom.
And he came with that idea, and we sat down and talked about it. Then we went to Director Carter and kind of laid it out on the table, man, and he was supportive. So we selected 22 officers across the state that is the Honor Guard program, and they have done – I know I'm going to get stuck here.
Yeah.
As long as I've been around, to me, that is the most heartfelt, most thing I'm proud of is the Honor Guard. It's very touching. It's very emotional. And then when you have employees that have retired and given their life service to our agency, and when you can honor them in some small token, whether it's a casket watch, whether it's a flag folding, a 21-gun salute, that's at least we can do for that person as he dedicated his life to our agency.
Public servant, yeah.
That's very powerful and very touching to me on a personal note. And these guys have done funerals. Matter of fact, yesterday the Metro Police, they were requested to be there to help greet and open doors for the Metro Police officer that lost his life trying to rescue a woman.
Yep. And we also helped a little bit with that rescue attempt on the water.
Yes, yeah. We had guys on the boat. So I get emotional about the Honor Guard. It's just very powerful to me, and what a great program. And then they've did a graduation ceremony for Toledo. They opened up the National Wild Turkey Federation with a Color Guard opening ceremonies. They've done another national convention. They participated in the Mississippi Warden Loss, Arkansas Warden Loss, South Carolina Warden Loss. So, man, what a very powerful group, and they are to be commended. Going above and beyond.
Yeah, that is
awesome. To
provide
those services.
And by the way, Toledo, what does that mean?
Tennessee Law Enforcement Training Academy.
Okay, so and that's where it's okay. That's and that's where we get a lot of our training. That's where wildlife officers go train, and
that's our standard state approved academy that all our officers, once they're hired, they'll have to go through. They bumped it up. When I went back in the day, it was only 8 weeks, but now they've seen the need for more subject matter, so they've increased that school to 12 weeks.
Let me ask you, me thinking about that now. How much training does, once a wildlife officer goes through all those years of college, how much training, like at Toledo, at the training academy, how much time there, and then how much every year after that?
Well, as the change, you know, we talked about 6 years ago merging the division, one of the improvements that we needed in me personally, I think training is absolute number one issue with law enforcement. Mm-hmm. As long as your training's good, the ultimate goal is for that officer to go home at night and be with his family. That's it, bottom line. So we've improved that training aspect from the day I hired, when they handed me a gun and badge and said, see ya, that same day, to now it's a regimented full 12 months worth of training. And inside that training, 12 months, 12 weeks, when we hire them, we'll get them for 6 to 8 weeks for orientation training that's agency specific. Then we send them to the basic training academy in Donaldson for 12 weeks. Then when they come out, they still have to be with a field training officer, which is our sergeants, and they in that program for 12 months. So this is a great improvement that we can indoctrinate these new hirees into the agency culture. So huge benefit, and training is number one.
Boy, it's a lot of training when you get going. Spend a lot of time on firing ranges?
Yes. Man, you drive on a driving track. You do close quarters boat handling. You do your handcuffing techniques. You do your rifle shooting, your shotgun shooting, your handgun shooting, all that above. And then another phase, those are in phases. And then we expose them to a waterfowl enforcement school, a bear enforcement school, elk enforcement school, commercial fishing enforcement school. We just set up something for them to go to a trapping school so they'll learn what's going on the trapping side of business and be more aware of our trappers. And it's just a full 12 months. It's very rigorous. So these new hirees, it'd been difficult 30 years ago for me to get through it, I guarantee you.
It is, without a doubt, it's tough. And since you started today, it's always, anytime you're in enforcement, it's always dangerous. You never know every day what you're going out there. But it seems to me, watching you guys or listening to you through the years, there's more to it now than ever. I think we had an officer, not in Middle Tennessee, I forget what county, that actually was on a river and came up on a floating meth lab.
Yes.
I don't remember what that was, but it's just what you run into these days, and you have to handle.
Yeah, and you got to be trained and be articulate on how to handle those. So, yeah, we should be very well prepared to handle all
this.
That's
what you have to train for everything now. It's just not as simple as talking to somebody about what they're hunting and fishing like. That's your main purpose, you never know. Okay, so we train. All right, we have a chaplain program too, which the honor guard, they sort of remind each other.
Right, and then they complement each other very well. And then
this is our website. You can actually learn about some of this on our web.
Yes, yeah. There's 10 guys that have gone through actually the Police of Chiefs national certification, so they've all been certified as chaplains. And Glenn Motes coordinates that. He's one of our lieutenant colonels for the Boating and Law Enforcement Division. So this group complements the Honor Guard group. There's presence there. And some of their efforts now, the hospital visits, if we have some retiree folks that have hospital stays, we have current employees that have hospital stays, they'll kind of swing by there and ask if there's anything we can do for them. And then what's unique here, this group has started a prayer list, if you will. So anybody that's interested in getting their prayer list. So they're a very active group. And then along with these retired honor guard functions, they'll complement that. So it's a neat group. They're very excited about the work they're doing and very proud of it.
And do you bring the officers all across the state, not just the ones that are stationed in Middle Tennessee? Are these officers representative?
Yeah, they're scattered throughout the state, and then the goal was try to have one per district spread out across the state. And we have, you know, 8 districts in the state, so there's representation across the state. And then even if the goal too is if an officer has just wants to talk to somebody, they're openly at their own free will to call one of these guys that will come to their need. And then that's part of that program was set up for anybody that just wants to talk about anything.
Cool deal. All right.
They got that set up.
All right, that's good. All right. Got something else that most folks don't know. Every now and then they'll see a truck go by, it's green and it's got the K and the 9 on there, or maybe they'll go to the turkey show and there'll be an officer out there. Amy Snyder comes to mind. She was at NWTF a few years ago, or one of the events we had, and she had a dog there, and people say, "You guys do dogs? What do we do with dogs?"
There's 9 canine handlers across the state, again, spread out as best we can for the best coverage. And these folks, these handlers, are good for search and recovery work. Those dogs are trained for canine article recovery in case somebody pitches a gun or a piece of equipment.
We had that happen the other day, right? Amy found with her dog a gun with a state trooper.
And then so those things are that's what they do. And then another component that's very popular is the school programs, the kids group. So when they go to schools and educate them on wildlife work, those dogs get exposed to a lot of school groups.
Okay. Do they train with those dogs?
Yes, every day. Yeah, there's it's another rigorous training program. They have to run tracks. They have to maintain a log of all their work, their hours spent out on the field. And so, yeah, it's a rigorous training program that they have to maintain.
And there's a video on YouTube, kind of an overview of our canine program, so you can watch that on YouTube.
If you love dogs, they're cool, and the dogs love people. They work when they work, and when they're off, they like to be petted like
They're
just dogs. They're just awesome things. All right. You also do every now and then we get called upon because you guys are enforcement and because you're really good in boats. If there is a disaster somewhere, Katrina comes to mind. Yes, down in Louisiana, New Orleans, South Carolina, right here in Nashville, Tennessee in 2010 and 11, terrible flooding. You guys got called and off you went.
Yeah, that's a big, big component that, again, through state law, we are to provide assets during natural disasters. And Tennessee is very blessed with those,
yeah.
More than we probably need. But flood work, ice storms are some of the things that in tornadoes, we're very, very rich in tornado work. So our guys have all the assets, whatever disaster is, whether it's aluminum boat with jet drive engines to get to these places during flood work for rescue to get them out of the flooded area. That's a big thing. Ice storms, we use ATVs to run up down an interstate for welfare checks on folks that have gotten locked down on the interstates. And just recently is the Gatlinburg
to check on
fire.
Their welfare, not for their welfare checks, right?
Right. Okay. We call them welfare checks. Make sure they got food and water, blankets, they're warm, all that stuff. And so ATVs.
Awesome.
The Gatlinburg fires is the most recent.
Yep.
We sent teams up there to help with assessment of areas that have been burned to see if there's anything that needed to be any survivors or deceased for recovery. And Mark, Katrina, we went to Katrina. We've gone to South Carolina, like you said. But our guys and gals that we have the assets, we have the skills, and we have the knowledge.
And you get called a lot.
So TEMA calls us often for those assets.
And you say TEMA, that's a Tennessee Emergency Management. And
yes.
At one time, our director, Ed Carter, was a big member of TEMA. Do we still have a TEMA representative? Are you it?
Well, actually, Glenn Motes is, we have a primary contact. He's
okay.
Our primary POC. And the other Lieutenant Colonel, Cape Taylor, is the secondary contact.
Okay.
So, yeah, by state law, we have to have a primary and a secondary.
Okay.
So those, I was too busy. I had all this other stuff.
I understand.
So, and Glenn and Cape do a fantastic job coordinating and dispersing our assets. And it's a lot of people don't know how often we are called during these disasters and what kind of manpower
and
assets.
Just got to be ready to roll.
Yeah.
And I bet you the officers, when you call them, I bet they jump all over it.
Man,
and
their truck's
to
gassed up, boat's got oil, boat's got gas, tires are good, supplies are good, and they're ready to roll.
Ready to roll. I just remember from the disasters that the ones that I knew about the most, and that was Katrina in 2010. I just remember how everybody was ready to go and win. And when you went down to Katrina, you stayed there for a long time.
About a week.
Yeah, and about crowded little, just all of you in one room. We're going to run out of time, but I do want to talk about the SIU, the Special Units. Is that right?
Special
Investigation Units.
And
what is that?
And basically that's a group of investigators that deal with a commercialization aspect. So if it's anything to do with commercialization of wildlife, that's their focus. And history, go back years ago to Operation Smokey, where bear gallbladders were the big thing. We were participated in that and had some very good outcomes of the illegal bear gallbladders. Then came a caviar case, the Russian caviar, where our paddlefish were getting taken for the egg to make the caviar. Striking distance was exotic snake, pet trade industry. And so those guys are very undercover.
Very undercover and very trained.
And very trained and do a good job when the commercialization of wildlife gets attention.
All right. Love to get them on. We're out of time. I'd love to get you back on here, Darren, and just talk about some of the cases that we've had through the years that are so interesting. You did a great job.
Man, that 30 minutes did go by
quick. Did go fast.
I got my hat, though.
It goes fast. Nice hat.
Shirt next time. Thanks, everybody, for watching.
Yeah, thank y'all. You can pick us up on tmwildcast.com and find everything right there. So keep coming back.
All right. Thanks, Colonel.
Thanks.